Our guest today is New York Times best-selling author and polling advisor to presidents, prime ministers, and CEOs. He currently advises leaders, national leaders, and their campaigns in Israel, Europe, South Africa, and Latin America. Our guest today was the senior pollster for President Bill Clinton and Vice President Al Gore, British Prime Minister Tony Blair, and Nelson Mandela. He founded his company 35 years ago after a decade of teaching at Yale University. Our guest today earned his undergraduate degree at Miami University and his PhD at Harvard University. Ladies and gentlemen, Stan Greenberg. Stan?
Thank you very much. Thank you to Jay Dougherty. Thank you to the City Club. When the publishers reached out, to build the tour for the book, which came out 4 weeks ago across the country, they wanted to start in Chicago. I'll go to Seattle next week. L.A. after that. Just finished the British part of the tour. But Chicago is the heart of it, and the mayor said the place to begin to build an audience for the ideas that are in this book are here at the City Club. These are the people who understand what's going on in the country at the economic, social, and cultural level, as well as being attuned to the political, a slight attuned to the political. And I have worked in Chicago and come here for a number of years two mayors, and so I'm familiar with the weather as well. So you can't fool me. I'm sure it'll be raining in Seattle. So thank you for the generous introduction. I want to start with Donald Trump. And I'm starting with Donald Trump because that'll be the first question asked. It was the first question I was asked when I walked through the door, and so why not just get it off the table? But I also want to build a bigger story from it, because I don't think Donald Trump is going to be the president. I'll come back to that in either in questions or in this discussion. I think it's more likely to be Cruz. But around what's happening right now in the primary, when I looked at Facebook before I gave a speech 2 days ago, you know, trending on Facebook was Planned Parenthood, Donald Trump, Christie Brinkley in her pictures of the 61-year-old model in the bikinis, and Ted Cruz saying the Democrats are falsely accusing the GOP of being condom police. So the four trending notes on Facebook were those four topics. It will tell you a lot, I think, about where the country is and where we've come to. But the argument I'm going to make is that's not America. These are morbid symptoms of the huge changes that are taking place in the country, and that while we should enjoy those, and they will have a big impact, they will have consequences for what happens in the short term, they don't be deceived by the smoke surrounding them. There's a different America going on. The America is the revolutions that I write about in this book, the economic, social, and cultural revolutions that are remaking the country, transforming the country. I didn't start out to write about those revolutions. I started to write out about the demographic and social and cultural trends that were creating a new majority. But I quickly discovered that you can't understand what's happening in the country unless you understand the dynamics that are remaking this country. We're talking about technology, internet and big data, innovation, revolutions in energy, revolutions in immigration, revolutions in racial and ethnic diversity, revolutions in the family and gender roles, revolutions in religious observance that are coming to an apex amongst the millennials and in the metropolitan areas of the country as we as the most dynamic areas emerge at the heart of our major cities, probably led by Chicago. And amidst those revolutions that are remaking the country, you end up seeing a country that is economically and culturally dynamic. And I conclude in the book, economically ascendant, despite everything one hears about China being the largest economy. When you get into the data, you'll see in this book that don't fail to bet on America economically. But the story I didn't really quite get was how culturally exceptional America was, driven by its continuing diversity and immigrant influx that interacts with its economic motor to make it a unique country. So these revolutions are, you know, are changing the country. And they are also, these revolutions, they're also interacting. And so that almost every prediction is wrong. There's almost no prediction on when things are happening and, or what scale they're happening. Because all the revolutions that we're talking about, whether it's immigration, gender roles, technology, all of them have an impact on each other that have the effect of accelerating the pace of change, and the remaking of America, therefore, is moving on at great speed. So consider this. 40% of New York City is foreign-born. 40% of New York City is foreign-born. And the largest group, Dominicans are the largest, but the second largest and close are the Chinese. And 5 years ago, no one had that as a prediction. That is just the who's coming, the scale of who's coming. If you look at the data on the debate around the immigration laws and the need to deal with skilled levels, what you begin to appreciate is America's conspiring through informal means to get past this problem. So half of the Silicon Valley engineers are foreign born. 80% of Chinese postgraduates, those who go to postgraduate school, stay in America. Don't go back to China. So that there is this informal process going on that is just accelerating the pace of change and changing the country. A majority of households now are unmarried. That happened about 2 years ago. And every trend I'm talking about is accelerating. A majority of households are unmarried. If you go into cities now, and this combines with millennials moving to the cities, 40% of the households are a single person. And which is changing, obviously, enormously what's happening in housing and rental and everything else. Church attendance is plummeting. And if you want to look at the line that's rising at the fastest rate, it's seculars. People who have no religion. It's moving to a quarter of the population who have no religion in the country. Seculars are growing. And so the seculars now outnumber mainline Protestants in the country. Working women are, three quarters of women are in the labor force. They are rushing into education, dominating education. Three quarters are in the labor force. Two thirds of women are the breadwinner or co-breadwinner. Two thirds are either breadwinner or co-breadwinner in the country. The racial minorities, 40% of the country are racial minorities. But more important than that number is the fact that 15% of the new marriages are interracial. And so you have this blending and constantly changing of the country produced by different attitudes as well as the increased diversity. You have movement, and all of this is in the last 5 years. This is not even a decade. You now have the population movement is going from the suburbs to the cities. Real estate values rising faster in the cities than the suburbs. More jobs created in the cities than suburbs. Millennials, we looked at surveys some years ago in which over 70% of millennials said they wanted to live in a big city. Two-thirds of college-educated millennials have already moved to the 50 largest cities. Okay, they've done it. It's done. That generation has decided, and if you do focus groups with millennials, you'll see how local their identity is, that they think about, they seem to identify with their city more than almost any other aspect of life, and family, but their city is what matters, and they've moved. This is done, baked, so into this. So those are the kinds of changes that we're talking about in the country, and as I said, in the book, I talk about how these things interact with the levels of basic and scientific research in the country, the fact that we have a military budget that sustains military research, basic research across the country. You have the interaction in cities with growing immigration and foreign population together with universities, military research, high-tech companies, all of which come together, and with the millennials, college-educated millennials moving into the cities, this churning that creates this dynamic country. However, there are three tsunamis that come with these changes in the country. The first tsunami is the fact that these revolutionary changes are producing a new American majority with different values, very different values, and if you focus on the growing portions of the country, so if you focus on racial minorities, single women will be one quarter of the electorate, unmarried or a majority. Anyway, single women a quarter of the electorate next year. If you focus on minorities, single women, millennials, and seculars, they were half the electorate in 2012. They will be 63% of the electorate next year. So these changes are just coming at an extraordinary pace. And every one of those growing groups in our polls are voting 2-1 for Hillary, which is why I've argued in a Washington Post op-ed that the country has moved beyond the tipping point on the political effects, of this majority. The second tsunami is the Republican Party's decision, and I think it was a decision, to wage a counter-revolution to keep this new majority from governing successfully. If you look back to the 2004 campaign that Karl Rove ran, the consultants were very surprised when Rove accepted the argument that there were 5 million evangelicals out there who did not vote in the prior election, and that if we try to energize our base with the risk with an animated culture war against what's happening in the country, we can engage those voters, bring them into the electorate. We shouldn't try to reach swing voters and independents. It's a pretty equally divided country. We can win these elections by engaging our base and polarizing the country. Now, I'm sure he was not focused on these long-term trends, because what happens is as you grow at such a dramatic rate for this new majority, you have to be ever more intense and ferocious, building up the fear that this majority will govern and govern by its values. This is a battle over American values. And it's not just a political exercise. When I first started writing the book and I looked at these trends, I thought they would take longer. One, I didn't realize how much they interacted. But I also didn't realize that the Republican Party would make this its reason for being and push aside other priorities in terms of stopping this majority from governing and governing by those values. The result is that the people who now call themselves Republican have changed pretty dramatically. And so one quarter of the Republican base voters, and I've polled them, and I write about it in the book, one quarter are Tea Party, and they are intensely anti-immigration. Do not underestimate how important immigration is. Both, it's important in why America is succeeding and how rapidly it's leading to change in the country, but also why it's so central to the battle within the Republican Party who are fighting these trends. And there's a strong anti-immigration sentiment. The feelings about immigration are as intense as attitudes toward Obamacare. And the Tea Party voters are the core of it, but they are a quarter of the base. 50% of the Republican base voters are evangelicals and religious conservatives, intense, strong religious conservatives, half of the base. and a quarter are moderates. People who are religiously moderate or, you know, or ideologically, politically moderate. Only a quarter. And so when what I have said from the beginning is that Trump's not going away. Trump will, he will capture that part of the counter-revolution within the Republican Party. However, I think I also argued that there will be a primary within the primary for who will be the social conservative, who will be the candidate that appeals to the religious core of the party. You had Ben Carson, I think, as a placeholder for that, but that vote's been spread across Ben Carson, you know, Cruz, Huckabee, you know, Santorum, you know, many candidates. And you also have Bush and Rubio, have also are very pro-life and have, you know, tried to compete for those voters. It's, I think, becoming clear as Ben Carson falls that Cruz is rising. And I think, you know, Cruz will, you know, emerge as the candidate that represents that, you know, block. And it's hard for me to see how Rubio, where there's another path for another candidate to be, to really surge. But we can go back to that in the questions. But the important thing is this counter-revolution. The first tsunami was the unbelievable pace of growth of this new American majority, the counter-revolution by Republicans over the last decade. But the third piece are the deep problems that have accompanied the revolutions that are making America economically and culturally dynamic. This is very much like the Industrial Revolution, and I write about it in historical terms, in which we were transformed by the steam engine, the Industrial Revolution, the unbelievable changes in productivity, huge shifts of population from Europe to the U.S., growth of cities, but also miserable conditions, and a reaction against that mitigated the excesses of that, you know, period. If we look at what's happening right now in America, you have 2/3 of Americans saying the country's on the wrong track. So I'm talking about this ascendant America that's so dynamic. You got 2/3 of Americans, you know, saying the country's on the wrong track. Over 60% of this new American majority that I think is poised to vote for Hillary thinks the country's on the wrong track. And the issues that are at the heart of that are the feeling that jobs don't pay enough to work on, live on, and there's an endemic cost of living crisis. People are piecing together jobs. You have accelerating inequality with all of the income gains now going to the very top. You have working class men marginalized in this economy and society, you know, as the male breadwinner role has crashed. You have working women on their own. Huge changes in women. The role they're playing with family and in work, with absolutely no change in the support that is provided, whether for child care or guarantees of equal pay or paid sick day and leave. So working women, deep discontent. More and more children are being raised by single parents. You have increased poverty in cities that are accompanying it. You have business viewed very negatively, CEOs in particular. Our own polling on just this neutral wording, CEOs of major businesses, people have a 2-to-1 negative view of CEOs, because it's seen that corporations the CEOs themselves have had huge bonuses, but the companies themselves have not invested in their own companies, wages have not risen, outsourcing, and so the companies are seen to be limiting opportunity. And then lastly is the corruption of politics and politics and business. The people believe that big money, lobbyists, billionaires, corporations are sponsoring politicians, and they use them to write the rules in government. And average people can't have much influence on what happens. And at the moment, that's like the dominant starting point of any discussion. And that's why you hear a Cruz and a Trump talk about crony capitalism, and hear all the Democratic candidates as well, you know, talk about it. And if you go back to the reform era of the that led to the mitigation of the excesses of the Industrial Revolution, they started with corruption, the linkage of politicians and business, starting local bartenders who are paying off to get licenses. Up to business and the trusts that were using the tariffs to have their monopolies and block foreign competition at the expense of consumers and workers. If you look at what Roosevelt ultimately was for, who was for barring corporate contributions, and Woodrow Wilson, he said the starting point, he didn't call it a progressive era, he called it America's renewal. I wanted to call my book American Renewal, not America Ascendant, because it's really about reclaiming core American values that need to be reformed. Now, what I argue in the book is that this is all happening. That is, we don't have to wait for Congress to be on gridlock. If you look in the cities, if you look at what's happening in business, if you look what's happening in the churches and states, just as in the progressive era, if you look at the press and the media, as well as muckrakers, that the pressure for reform and real reform is happening together in the cities, together with business in the states that are already mitigating it. And this process gains momentum from the city and states, and the process is ongoing. And I would also say, finally, that I believe the Republican Party will change dramatically after this election. I think this will be a shattering election because I think these forces have come together, and I think will confirm the scale of these changes. But I think it will immediately produce a new debate within the Republican Party on accepting the gender roles in the country, accepting the fact that we're a diverse and immigrant country, accepting that we have to invest in education and infrastructure, that things that have been kind of bipartisan and national, I think will find champions after this election in the Republican Party. So my conclusion from what's really happening on the ground and what's happening, I think, will happen after this election, shaped by these big forces, will produce a happy ending and a happy future for America. Thank you.
Do you have questions right about? Young Amanda here. By the way, Stan, I hate to tell you this, but on June 29th of this year, some of you were here. Who was standing at this podium? Donald Trump. And I certainly hope your book takes off the same way he took off. Because we were the start, and if he becomes president, you're looking at many members of his cabinet here. that was one of the days to remember. Police, protesters, more selfies taken than in the history of the City Club. All right. Joe Thornton, American Medical Association, otherwise known as Tweed's dad. You sound more hopeful than I would have expected. With the polarization of politics and harsh campaigning, do you have any hope that Congress will heal itself and be effective? Good question.
Good. Very good question. I was more hopeful than I... Where's the question? Questioner was over... Okay. I need to look at you. I wrote a more hopeful book than I expected to write. In the acknowledgments at the end of the book, you'll see that I thank the candidates and the activists that I worked for in countries around the world. And so when I would work in Venezuela, where people were out on the street, demonstrations, people were going to jail, we'd come back and we'd meet, and they say, "How's Obama doing? How's Hillary doing?" They are rooting for America. They think America is dynamic. They see all the innovation. It's where they want to be. It's the only welcoming country in the world. They may not think that given Trump and given what's happening in the Republican primary. In my acknowledgments, that shaped the way I wrote about America. The other thing that shaped it was my experience dealing with anti-immigration parties, in Europe. So I was hired by the Jewish community in Vienna to run the campaign to try to reduce the power of Haider's party and the Freedom Party in Austria, in Vienna and Austria. And I later worked for the Jewish community in France this year on trying to deal with the problem of the Front National. And so you begin to appreciate that there's no other country that can deal with diversity, that has any kind of framework for, you know, welcoming. There's, you know, there's Brazil, there's Canada, but it's pretty exceptional to have a country that finds new and new ways to welcome diversity and immigration and then that foreign influence. So part of my optimism, you know, comes from that. But the other part comes from just believing that I think we've reached the point, the gridlock is, I think we'll view 2 years from now, maybe 5 years from now, as historical. That it was the worst part of the attempt to stop this new American majority from governing. It's over if this majority plays out and this counter-revolution fails. I think you will see different forces within the Republican Party. You know, I that's from my own experience. The 1984 for the Democrats, we nominated our core candidate, a pro-union guy, Walter Mondale, was challenged by, you know, Gary Hart. You know, but in the next election after that, Gary Hart, you know, would have been the nominee, but for the sex scandal, he might have been elected president. Bill Clinton was elected in 92. It took a landslide, 60-40 landslide election for the Democrats to go with the modernizers. And I think the modernizers will be empowered, you know, once this is, you have nothing but frustrated Republicans, whether it's the establishment, you know, or voters who are on the edge, because they're losing their voters, you know. But I think the country needs a Republican Party.
Stan, we have a lot of questions. And
I'll be shorter.
We're not serving lunch. all right. Now, I was going to ask this question, but Alderman Joe Moore beats me to the punch. City council members do that often. In light of the demographic changes you refer to in your talk, how do you explain the ascendancy of the Republican Party in the states, more Republican governors, more Republican state legislatures, and, of course, something which we don't have this problem in Illinois, gerrymandering redistricting? People rule. There you go, Stan.
Okay, again, a good question, and I would say after the Trump question, the most frequent question I get is, well, if the Democrats are doing so well, how come they're losing all these elections?
That's a good question.
Good question. Well, I hadn't thought about that before, but this question prompts me to think about it. And I have like three answers to it. One has to do that relates to what I said in the previous one. I think this was a period in which every election was nationalized for the Republicans, in which they had to get more and more energized and more engaged to keep this majority from winning. You know, when it was, you know, 40% of the electorate's one thing. When it was 63%, it's, you know, entirely different. They have to have total unity and energy. The result was you had a 2014 election, lowest turnout, you know, since World War II, off your election during World War II. But Republicans were engaged to stop Obama from succeeding. And Obama kind of represented he represented the values of this coalition. And so their voters had a reason for voting. But again, I believe we will look at it as kind of the last chapter, you know, or the last scene, you know, of that movie, you know, after it got played out. And then I think we'll have a different dynamic. I think winning and all, I mean, who votes in presidential and off-year elections, I think that dynamic will change, you know, after this election because of how shattering I believe this will be. We'll have new dynamics on who's engaged and who's not engaged. Democrats did not have a real reason for voting. Republicans had a compelling reason to vote, and I think that's the most important part of it. But there's some pieces that are not going away. If the Republican support was spread evenly across the country, you know, they could do what they're doing, and we would see change much more faster. But because of the constitutional bias of our system in favor of rural areas, their support is in the deep South, the most racially conscious parts of the country, in the most religiously observant parts of the country, which is, you know, Appalachia is where it's strongest, you know, carrying on to the rural and, you know, plain states and Rocky Mountain states where Mormons are strong. But their support is in the most rural parts of the country, the most race conscious, religious conscious, and rural. Okay, in a country, as we've seen, that's becoming more urban, younger, and less and more secular. But because they have a regional base that's rural, and we give equal representation to states in the country, so you have 20 states. You know, they've made gains beyond that, but just take the 20 states in which they really are ascendant based on the values that they're battling for. You know, that's 40 senators as a start when you get to the Senate. And the other part has to do with reapportionment and the difficulty of representing the populations when one party's vote is increasingly to the most densest urban areas and the other's is increasingly to the rural areas. It is much easier to represent that, you know, that in the, it's much harder to get full representation, you know, for the Democrats in that environment, given those, you know, tendencies. So it's not going away. There's going to be a battle. And why I think this is different is I don't assume that the same gridlock polarization is going to continue, that there's going to be a debate within the Republican Party. And once you have a debate within the Republican Party, you can't have the same kind of each election being Armageddon if we don't stop them from governing. Because, in fact, you now have Republicans who are saying, well, maybe we should be investing in education. Maybe we should be doing long-term infrastructure investment in the country. Maybe we should be talking about child care and ways to do child care for, you know, working women. Once that's taking place within the Republican Party, I think you end up with a different dynamic and even have the chance to actually pass things cross-party, which we used to be able to do.
You know about the great map maker in Illinois. That goes against what you just said. The Honorable Michael J. Madigan.
I know.
One of my old professors, Mr. Mazur, knew him very well, Milton Rakoff, said, if you have a choice between controlling the pencil or controlling 500 precinct workers, take the pencil. Write it down, kids, to be on the exam. All right. Matt Curry. Where are you, Matt? All right. Now, it's a little tough to read, but it's a good question. I'll doctor it up a little bit to make it worse. What is the electoral distribution of these rising groups? If millennials, singles, etc., continue to move from Ohio and Missouri to Chicago and San Francisco, how does that impact the electoral map? You're not in the minor league here, Mr.
Murphy. Key question. Well, first of all, it's not just the millennials. So you're talking about the growth of you know, Hispanic and African American population. You're talking about the growth of foreign born and immigrant populations, together with the millennials and, you know, also college educated. You know, when I looked at, you know, in the, it's not on your question, but I'll get to it. When I looked at the, because I polled for the mayor here, I polled for the mayor and polled for the mayor in New York City. And I look at the white population of these cities. Now, you think of these cities as cities that have strong ethnic populations, strong working class populations, and a strong history. In both New York City and here, 2/3 of the whites had college degrees, 4-year college degrees or more, in this city and in New York City. And so the notion of who's living in cities is, like, you know, just dramatically changing as a result of these changes. What's happened on the Electoral College map is that you have these metropolitan centers that are growing, that are dynamic and very diverse. And so Virginia is probably a purple state. Virginia's maybe blue. Has moved beyond because of Northern Virginia and the. Which are the Washington suburbs, have their own, you know, dynamism that are moving, have moved that state. You have the core of Colorado, you know, creating that same dynamic there. You have metropolitan areas in Nevada, in Florida. And so the trends I'm talking about all work together. They're not one on their own, that are making these places younger, people are coming in, more diverse, more foreign born, and are shifting. If you look at Florida, if you assume that whites vote the same way they did when Obama ran, and you have just the growth of the both by age and, you know, and by ethnicity, you know, particularly the Hispanic growth, non-Cuban Hispanic growth, you would expect the Democrats to win by 6 in Florida. They won by 1, just in the growth. If the white vote stays as it is, so the dominant impact, you know, of these trends is to bring more and more states, you know, into the Democratic orbit rather than the opposite.
We have a couple of questions that are very similar. Oops. That threw me off a little. I have my rhythm here. You have. We have the Honorable Ed Mazur saying, will the Obama actions, inactions in his second term be a plus or minus to the Democratic presidential nominee in 2016? We have Kurt Wiley. Will America elect a President Hillary that the don't like what? Okay, we'll leave that line out. Will America elect a President Hillary? And the third one, do the demographic, this is from John P. O'Neill, with, by the way, excellent printing. Do the demographic changes that are happening signal the end of our two-party system? If so, do you think we will see a single dominant party or an expansion in the number of political parties? So, two-point question, taking three questions. Will the Democrats elect will the people elect a Democrat in 2016? How will the Obama administration affect that campaign? And are we looking at to extend your remarks, a new dominant Democratic Party in the near future?
So, and well done, cleverly done, and well read and well written in some cases. Let me start with the President Obama. And this new American majority and attitudes toward the president. I know him in Chicago, and I'm a big fan. I believe President Obama will be viewed to have an historic presidency, include how he managed the financial crisis and getting us out of the deep recession. I think it'll include foreign policy issues like Cuba and Latin America, the Iran agreement. As well as you know, ending our deep military involvement abroad in Afghanistan and Iran, and so I think we will, you know, look back and the Affordable Care Act, you know, in terms of social policy, will be viewed as successes, and I think a very important presidency. But he did not address the issues that I've talked about here. When I said these revolutions are creating these problems. These have been building through his presidency. And this new American majority actually doesn't have a lot of confidence in the president or the Democrats on addressing those problems. If I ask the question, who do you trust on the economy? The Republicans are ahead by 6 points right now. And it never really closed under President Obama. His economic framework was the recovery. And it's historic. And I've worked for people. I was in Britain. I watched with Gordon Brown. When you've been through that kind of searing experience of a financial crash, and you bring the country back, you think you've saved the world from a global recession. You know, it I think fundamentally shapes your consciousness. And the president's economic framework is getting the country back to recover, getting back to where it was before the financial crisis. That would be considered a great success, and probably history will consider that a success. But for the people living in this changed economy with these building issues, they are like almost unimportant. Because we're talking about getting back to the pre-recession when the incomes were declining going into the recession. This is not nirvana you're going back to. And so, the president has not educated on these issues, including many of the social issues having to do with family and children, as well. And so when you're talking about how a Democratic candidate runs, I think they will all be both applauding his presidency, but also saying he didn't address these issues. This is a new chapter. We'll build on it, but this is a new chapter. So they will, you know, they will be about running for change. You can't have two-thirds of the people saying they want a change in direction of the country and have elect Democrats. Democrats have to be about change, which means you have to establish some, you know, distance, or at least an interpretation of the Obama presidency that you can build from. And I think that's how they will, you know, relate to it. I think Democrats have been given, handed the torch to address these problems because the Republicans have ruled themselves out. You know, so, I mean, just give an example of the what's happening with the family and children, what's happening with, you know, single women, parent, kids being being raised by a single parent, and that whole, you know, issue. Okay. Republicans still are suing under the Affordable Care Act on contraception. I mean, that's their kind of, they're still battling coverage on contraception in fighting the Affordable, you know, Care Act. They are still fighting, you know, the marriage equality, you know, gay marriage. They, if you look at the, and I've read conservative journals, economic journals, who question why the Republicans, actually, these presidential candidates don't have any child care policies, because they still want public policy to privilege a male breadwinner family with and favor, and certainly not have policies that actually seem to favor helping working women who've made a choice not to raise. They haven't resolved that issue. So it's very hard to bring Republicans into that discussion if they're still fighting. They haven't accepted the basic changes that are taking place. Now, I think they are. In other words, I think we're going to have a big election in which you're going to have, I think women have been suppressed. If you look at the two women senators from Maine, they voted against the pay equity laws, you know, because they're in a party that, you know, that is, you know, is, doesn't allow the, you know, wouldn't allow them to break off. I think the dynamic in the Republican Party is going to be different. So I think Democrats are being handed the torch by default. I don't think this is one party rule. I think the reason why this new majority did not vote in the off-year election is because Democrats were not addressing these issues. There was no reason to vote. And they will be challenged coming out of this election, you know, because they will run on these issues. If you look at the agenda, you know, that Hillary's running, I think Hillary will win. I think that's one of the questions. They will run on an agenda of addressing these issues. I think it's they're all pretty bold and I think pretty consistent. But then the question will be, are you delivering, you know, on this new agenda now that you say you're addressing these problems? It's not, these are hard problems to address. These are huge issues. And you won't have total control, you know, of government, and you won't have total control, obviously, of states. And so it's, you know, you could easily have people in the off-year elections 2 years from now, leading into the election 2 years from now, with Democrats being discontented with, you know, the progress of the new president. And so I don't have a linear path here where Democrats are the dominant party. I think this is, there's a lot to play out before we know who will govern.
We've got three short answer questions and one closing question, which you can elaborate. So, Kay Whitlock, Christopher Burke Engineering. Very simple question.
for the lunch?
For the
lunch?
Could you tell them that election rules, kind of when the polls close, you know, you have to be in the polling place. Well, we'll check this to see, but this is a highly unusual for the City Club, where rules are firmly entrenched. All right. As I was saying, very simple question. Kay Whitlock, where's Kay? Right here. I know. When and how, well, I can't give him when and how. We'll give him two quick answers. When and how will the revolution change gun control?
That's the only one I'm getting?
Well, no. That's the first of the short answer question.
God, I wish I could tell you that I think this will happen. I think the good news is that I do believe that the Democratic presidential candidates will run on it, and it will be central to and this new American majority very strongly, you know, supports gun control, and President Obama actually downplayed the gun issue in his elections, and so that'll be a change. But you have the entrenchment, you know, in the states that I've talked about that are going to be, you know, very resistant to it. By the way, I didn't realize when I put my phone on silence, but I didn't know my watch would ring. So I didn't turn off my watch. I just declined from my watch. I apologize for the technology. I think it's not going to happen. Yeah, I think the resistance is so great that I would, you will, I think Hillary or the Democrat, I think Hillary will make it part of her platform. And I think you'll revisit the issue, but they didn't get close, you know, in the last time they brought it to the Senate. I think they'll take it forward. I'm not real optimistic that you would get anything that's significant.
Okay. Lally Dorr? American kids are... Oh, I thought that was your... Okay. American kids are behind in math and science, ranked 9. How can we overcome the lack of skilled workers?
I mean, by the way, part of this book is the I'm a little bit more. First of all, I'm a little more optimistic about America and how it's invested, what it's investing in education. There's no doubt that there's need for education reform to produce much better outcomes. And I talk in the book and using the some McKinsey studies on what kinds of policy changes would produce a different kind of workforce. But understand, over in this period of gridlock, this is the first period where we've actually started to cut R&D, where that has begun to fall nationally. That if you look at the federal education budget, that's declined in support for education. And in the states, you've also, seen cuts in spending for education and training in the states, particularly in these Republican-controlled states. And it's almost can't understand the what's happening in the area of education and why there's a, because what I'd expect conservatives to do to want to have less federal support for an involvement in education, but to support it locally. But it looks like the pressure is to cut it, at both levels. But I don't think it's not a popular model. If you look at this cutting of education and money for training, if you look at Louisiana, where the Jindal was an amazingly unpopular governor of Louisiana, and he led by his cuts in education. He was cutting corporate taxes and taxes in order to, and he was quite wedded to cut education, training, universities. But it's not popular. And I think one of the changes we may see is that that across the country, regardless of state, that you begin to see a battle back to support it, because the public is looking for it. They are hungry for strategies on how they get the training and skills to be able to do better. And obviously, we can't have the growth without it.
Okay, another real short question. And given your comments up to now, you should really make this a pretty short answer. What role do you see the conservatives having in the future of our nation?
God, I have to be
shooting. That's from, I'm sorry, that's from Lindsay Goders? Lindsay, I'll just call you Lindsay.
What's happened with these trends and what's happened with the this kind of counter-revolution and polarization that I've talked about is that the percentage of people who are conservatives have dropped from 47% kind of at the height in 2010 when the Republicans were the strongest, from 47% to 37% now. So it's been like in a very short period, 5 years. A 10-point drop in the number of people calling themselves conservative. But that's because conservative is defined in almost entirely in cultural and values terms rather than economic terms. And I think this changes once we have an election in which this counter-revolution clearly is lost. And then I think you begin to get conservatives reclaiming, business conservative and other types of conservatism which have been crowded out, by the... particularly if Cruz is the candidate, it'll even drop even further. But I think this is not linear. That is, I think these trends are, we're at a disruptive moment in which I think there's going to be a regrouping afterward.
Okay. I'm combining the last two questions. This is your final question. This is from Joe Calasari and from Kevin Jackson. Both of them basically asked the same thing. To what extent does economic mobility, or the lack thereof, fuel political reform, and combining that with how will income inequality be closed?
Finishing with an uncomplicated question that can be answered with a...
Take as much time as you like.
Okay. Yes.
Expand.
Okay. Look, I spent a lot of time in the book talking about what's happened with the lack of mobility, income mobility, but also racial segregation in the cities, because this dynamism in the cities is associated with actually increased inequality. These dynamic cities have more inequality, but there are policies that one can do that affect it. I mean, affordable housing, access to transportation. More parenting and more parents attentive to the kids, support for early childhood, early education, zero to three. There are a whole range of things that one can do to affect mobility. And to be honest, the toughest one is children being raised by single parents. That's, if you look at the studies on inequality, the biggest predictor, are the cities in counties, that have more unmarried households. And so we have to be able to address that. It's why I'm hoping that Pope Francis, changes the debate in terms of the willingness of everyone, not just conservatives, for everyone to begin to address those kinds of, issues. And that really does break out of the box. There are, at the beginning of the book, in the first chapter, at the end of it, I talked about what happened with the Bill Clinton presidency, where they enacted a deficit reduction package that included new high top rates on the wealthy, expansion of the earned income tax credit, and a number of other policies. Later, they would add to it the child tax credit. And what you, if you look at what happened in the 90s, you saw a decline of inequality, decline of poverty, median income, grew. That there are policies. This is not a mystery. This is not rocket science. We know how to do things in which we can have, less poverty and middle incomes rising and less inequality. And it's not that complicated, the policies that are there. And I talk about the policies in the book. So I think the question is, can you get there to do it? Part of my critique of the Democrats is, if you look at the, pattern of contributions to the Democrats, they are increasingly getting their money from the top 1% or the 1% of the 1%, and a smaller and smaller proportion from the middle. And so are the Democrats willing to change the system? I believe there is a correlation between the role of money in politics and the willingness of politicians to do things that affect inequality. So I think the starting point is political reform, which is, for me, the fact that Hillary has made that one of the four areas she wants to address says that we may indeed be able to create the political force to act to address it.
A round of applause. Well done.
That part he just...